So good morning, everybody. It's great to be here, and I really enjoyed the sessions yesterday. They've asked me to give just a brief overview, which is hard to do when you've been working in something for now close to 20 years. But that's what I'm going to try to do is just create a little bit of a frame around this, notion of the role of agency in the transformation of complex systems, linked social ecological systems. That quote up there by Gareth Morgan, farmers don't grow crops, they create conditions for crops to grow, really is a summary of just about everything that I've learned about institutional or social entrepreneurs and how they do work. But I should add before I start that, you know, for me, this has been a journey of a lot of hope, because it's hard to work with people and who are doing this kind of work, and you're going to hear from one shortly, without feeling a tremendous sense of hope. And Paul Hawkins was doing his stream of organizations that were working. I mean, that's the world that I've lived and worked in for quite a while. So how did I start out on this journey? I started out on this journey by getting interested in complex adaptive systems and complexity, and thinking initially about the notion of leadership. And as you all know, and some of you have touched on this in your presentation, there's a fundamental paradox around the notion of agency if we adopt a complex system lens. If, in fact, the world is operating on the principles of complex systems, the edge of chaos, the emergence, the critical transitions, et cetera, that you can't actually understand based on any individual, their behavior, their thoughts, their dreams, their aspirations, then how do we find leadership in that? How does leadership coexist with this kind of situation? And we often think in this. If I can make this go, there we go. I believe. Oh no, sorry. Let me go back. If I can get that. Oh, it's not going to play. Strange. Okay. What I had there, which I'd like to show at this juncture, is a flock of birds. It's amazing to watch a flock of birds, and there's this film that's called Swallows on Exmoor. You can get it as a YouTube film, and it's an amazing picture of these birds that every evening swarm and flock. And when you see a flock of birds, they're like the epitome, and people often use them as example of a chaotic system, right? Because they seem to form shapes. They're definitely shapes, they have a boundary, and yet it seems quite random. And there's these sudden discontinuities, and the pattern changes again, and yet instantly it's a new pattern. It's a recognizable shape. And they swarm and move like that literally for hours. And there's been work done saying, well, initially the assumption was that these patterns were formed by birds following a leader bird. The same with things like slime mold, you know, that they clump together because there is a leader slime mold that signals that it's time to clump together. But the fact is that, you know, further research on this indicated that you actually can't get there by following a leader. So, for example, when you think of a flock of birds, if you were following a leader and the first bird hit a window, they'd all hit the window because they wouldn't have time to react. And yet you see one bird hitting a window, but you do not see a flock of birds hitting a window. Because, in fact, there are other kinds of principles with which they react. So then the question is, again, you know, where is leadership in this swarm, in this flock of birds? Where do we see it? Is it leadership? Is it, you know, following in the footsteps of someone who sets a stage? Or actually, is it more like an avalanche, which we just get swept along in, or we can choose to step into or out of? Is it actually a force that's much broader than ourselves? You know, we know that agency is key. There's a lot of wonderful studies. I mean, starting way back with Bridges and Barriers, where I first got involved in doing resilience work, everyone recognizes that there are individuals that play this very, very key role. They arrive, people recognize them, they can point to them, they can say this or these people. We know that without them, somehow on the landscape, things don't happen. You can have lots of social capital, you can have strong community, you can have challenges, you can have threats, and yet people will not respond in many cases without, in fact, individuals who at least people attribute, and I think that's rather important because it's a question of perspective, people attribute leadership too. So they, we know it's there, but really the issue is, you know, how does it operate? And that's what started me on this journey. And myself and several colleagues started to talk to people who were recognized as these kinds of leaders. And what, one of the things that we first learned was that we couldn't use that language. They didn't want to be called leaders. Leaders have followers. And they actually didn't want to have followers. They wanted to operate under the radar screen. They wanted to be able to move agilely and lightly through the system. And so they didn't want to be known as leaders. In fact, sometimes it was hard to get to them. You would see that the system was moving, and you'd say, well, what's going on here? But you'd have trouble getting to them. And so we ended up looking, you know, finding under that initial paradox, as we talked to them, three other paradoxes. The first is really the paradox of action, which is that these leaders both felt that they needed to stand still to pay enormous and intense attention to what was going on. And at the same time, they had this sense of urgency and aspiration, which we call getting to maybe. They felt like, you know, they had to move forward, and they had a kind of vision. I mean, again, the thing about saying we can't imagine, you know, transformation. Well, these individuals could imagine that transformation. They could see what they would like the world to look like, and they felt an enormous urgency. Then there was a second one, which was a kind of paradox of power. That on the one hand, the particular system in which these individuals was engaged to try to change it was a system that had power, authority, resources, distributed generally, not evenly, as we're familiar with. This came up yesterday. But in fact, they felt that they had to encounter and deal with that power, but there were also moments in the system, much like that flock of birds, when actually they felt that they were just swept along. And we call that, you know, let it find you. It actually, they would say, if I've got it right, it will actually grab me and sweep me along. If I'm finding endless barriers, it means I'm going about it the wrong way. And that we heard that over and over again, that sense of the energy and power in the system, which is kind of nice, right? Because that's where you begin to bring these things together. We talk about emergent properties and complexity. Then we are assuming there are these forces. And basically what they were saying was, you don't fight and encounter it. You actually step into the flow of an avalanche if you've gotten it right. And we had a third paradox, which was the paradox of success. The interesting fact, and again, a nice piece of complexity, that it, you know, innovation and change or sustainability is not a fixed destination. It's not someplace you get to. It's someplace where you're continuously trying to get to, and there's always more to do. And so there were moments of terrible failure, and in those moments of failure, they often found a source of a new inspiration. And there were moments of success, and at those moments of success, they often felt, oh, there's so much to do. So there's a way in which it was an ongoing and cyclical process. And they would go round and round and round dealing with these paradoxes. These are pictures of some of the individuals, some of them working in the environmental domain, some of them not, with whom we worked. So I'm not going to go into their stories, but the last piece was, as Per mentioned earlier, the notion of opportunity. It seems as if, with all the kind of detailed work that goes on with these individuals, they also are very alive to the fact that it's about opportunity, that in fact they have to wait for the right moment when things are lined up and they can, in fact, move ideas very quickly. So it really isn't a kind of social movement lens. It isn't man the barricades, you know, the enemy is outside there, we need to confront that enemy, and then, you know, through the force of our will or our collective action, we will overcome it. It's rather, you know, a kind of a zen of transformation, where you wait for the moment when the avalanche is coming, and you can just step into it, and in a sense, it carries you. So those were some of the kind of surprising things we found, and, you know, the language there doesn't sound very scientific, does it? And we wrestled a lot with that, and we were informed by the work of a poet and organizational thinker whose name is David White, some of you may have heard of. And we found that, actually, as we started to encounter these behaviors, that we couldn't use the normal leadership or something. We couldn't talk about planning, controlling, and determining, et cetera. We couldn't use that language, because what they were doing had this slightly mysterious, intuitive kind of quality to it that just didn't fit into those categories. That doesn't mean we can't get, and one of the things that I always try to do is to get to a language that you can understand, but it did mean that we didn't have the right words. And we began to look elsewhere, actually, into much more poetic language to try to recognize the constellations of what were happening. We found that to be actually quite powerful. It helped us to understand what was going on. So an interesting role for that kind of creative endeavor. So we ultimately arrived at a point where we were defining social innovation as changing the system that created the problem in the first place. And we were very concerned that most of the issues that you see ultimately are being constructed by these broad institutional frameworks. And so for institutional entrepreneurs, it wasn't just about having, or these individuals which we began to call entrepreneurs, it wasn't just about a new idea. Actually, it was about creating a different kind of transformation. So transformation or adaptation, for many of them, it was just a question of a perspective and degree, not something that you should struggle with, that ultimately adaptation is going to maintain the resilience. If you've got a system you like and you want to make it more resilient, you come up with innovations that help it to continuously adapt and learn. If you're in some part of the system or subsystem that you think has to transform, you don't want resilience. You actually want to be able to kind of overturn it and change the rules. And they work really on this notion of human institutions. And human institutions aren't organizations. They're much more pattern set of behaviors and meanings which kind of structure it. And we think of patterns which structure language and understanding and the meanings and beliefs. We think of those. We think of patterns that are embedded in our rules, our procedures, right up to our laws. And we have ones that are embedded in a pattern of power and economics, which we often think of as structures. So all conservation, ecological resilience issues actually are embedded in certain kinds of institutions. I remembered, encountering this very, very acutely when I was working with a group that worked on endangered species and being at a meeting where there was a highly contested meeting about the fate of a particular species, endangered species, the northern white rhino. And there were different groups who felt that they were the ones who should champion this particular, who knew the solution. And they had very different notions of what that animal was. It was a child, a meal, a crown jewel. Really very different. And that engendered different roles and routines, whether you're going to capture them, protect them, care for them. And they had very different notions of how resources, therefore, should flow in order. And this is to protect these animals or not, and this is being played out in a highly contested global stage. And so one of the kind of hopeful things that I began to realize is that with these kinds of entrepreneurs, as they zoom into the here and now, they're not trying to change the whole world. They're just trying to change those meanings, those rules and relationships, those particular patterns and structures, and they do it right where they are. And some of those changes have more radical implications, some have less, but they start right where they are. So they work to change a perception, to transform the way things are seen. When you look at what an ecosystem is or what it means to conserve it, you think of the notion of planetary boundaries, a fundamental change in perception that I think comes out of the Stockholm Resilience Center, and people now think of that differently. Or they change the kind of form and function. They look to change the structures that govern, for example, the approaches to managing an ecosystem. Or they act to transform very immediately the rules and relationships to say, let's interact differently around this. Let's be different in our interactions and in the patterns that we look at. Let's be more playful, less serious, let's be more holistic, less particular, let's work as cross disciplines instead of inside disciplines. And so they, depending on their particular interests and where they start, they work on all of these or on some of them. And they work across scales. So right from organizations up to very broad social systems, you see these actors, a network of actors, working with people who create good ideas. They don't necessarily create them themselves, because a lot of them work with people who are the inventors And that happens at community levels. It happens at grassroots levels. That's where people solve those problems. But they see it as their job to be constantly looking at the broader institutional governance system in a country or at a global level to find opportunities where they can connect that idea, where they can question what's going on up there. They can frame it for the people who are trying to do the innovation. They can sell the idea up when the right moment comes, because they do know people who are in government, who have the resources, who have the power. And in fact, you know, they can actually frame it down, and so people can continue working there. So they work together, and they work alone. They also work, as Franz Werhout said yesterday, there's a narrative of phases around transformation, and the one that we work with, those of us in resilience, is partly this one about an adaptive cycle. And we've just finished a piece that's coming out shortly. Per and I and Carl were working on it, where we actually looked across a number of cases where environmentally based management came in and at the actors who were working there. And we saw them switching strategies. You know, there was places where they were disturbing and questioning the context, convening or framing. Then they were identifying and choosing and building partnerships, brokering, and ultimately trying to sell these ideas up to the broader system so that they do become institutionalized. They're not all equally good. Some of them are equally good at all of them, but not all of them. So, you know, in fact, that's one of the reasons why networks exist. So, you know, ultimately, in summary, really, what we begin to see is a pattern of the difference between successful and unsuccessful initiatives lying in this network of actors who not just recognize that an innovation is there, but recognizes its transformative potential and works to connect it to opportunities in the broader institutional system. Sometimes those are technical things. Sometimes they're just changes in the rules and relationships or how people see things. And those are the things that they're trying to sell. The particular skills of such sort of system entrepreneurs, whether there are many terms for it, institutional entrepreneurs, policy entrepreneurs, cultural entrepreneurs, you can find a literature for each of these, are still under development. We're still trying to recognize them. But a lot of it is what are really these soft skills that aren't well described in management literature or leadership literature, convening, sense-making, brokering, anticipating, selling, questioning. And they often themselves use a language that is not scientific, and that I think in the interest of these kinds of integrated knowledge that we have to take very seriously, because it describes a kind of experience that maybe we haven't got full access to if we're not ourselves these kinds of actors. It's the language of transformation. So I just want to leave you with one poem, which for me it was one of the most stimulating ones, and it's called Lost. It's by David Wagner. So it goes, stand still. The trees behind you and the bushes beside you are not lost. Wherever you are is called here. And you must treat it as a powerful stranger. Must ask permission to know it and to be known. The forest breathes. Listen. It answers. I have made this place around you. If you leave it, you may come back saying, here. No two trees are the same to raven. No two branches are the same to wren. If what a tree or a bush does is lost on you, then you are truly lost. Stand still. The forest knows where you are. You must let it find you. Thank you. I'll leave it at that.